Hi, this is Gloria, your life coach. Welcome to another episode of Life Say Shuffle.
Hi, this is Ron Johnson, your life coach, leadership coach, motivational speaker, and health coach. And welcome to another episode of Life Say Shuffle. Today's Thursday, and you know what that means. Freestyle Thursday, no topic. Let's catch up. What's going on? So I'm thinking about top of my head right now. What's going on with me? I'm settled. I'm in Bellingham, finally in the house. I think the thing I'll never forget is those that move and know it's pain in the ass no matter what. If you do it yourself, if you hire movers, it's the pain. So we hired movers to move from Milpitas to Bellingham. And, you know, they showed up on time. They're like 15 minutes early. And it's like five guys. They're out in and out like 2.5 hours. Because I already knew is I hate moving. So I'm going to make it easy for everybody, including myself. So Home Depot, Lowe's, spent the last 2 months getting all these totes from 27-gallon, 64-gallon. I had to move my whole home gym, too. So what I did is I brought these humongous 64-gallon totes. They were so heavy, even with wheels, you can move it. So we took all the weights out, put an empty tote on top of a cart with four wheels, put on top of there, and then put the weights on top of that cart so it's easy to move around. Because once something is on wheels, you can push it around. It doesn't matter. So 22nd October rolls around, and they're supposed to be delivered. Now, like I said before, they had five guys to move us from Milpitas into the truck. The delivery people here was only two guys, okay? And you have to go up a hill into our community. And this truck, this is a humongous truck, could not go up the hill. No matter if you went front, you went at an angle, this angle, back at an angle, it didn't happen. Then about two guys for the same amount of load. We end up, Karina and I, end up moving all our stuff. I would say it had to be 150 feet. It took us 4 hours. We were so wore out. So it's like, what's the point in having movers or hiring movers when you got to move your own stuff? So I kind of felt bad for them. It's, you know, it's not their fault. It's the moving company's fault. They should have did more logistics, but man, I just don't want to move for the next 10 to 15 years. You know, just I'm over the moving part right now. That was a lot of work. Luckily, I work out. I'm in good shape because if you had any kind of health conditions, forget about it. I mean, I was trying to wear a mask for safety purposes for COVID and the pandemic. I looked at the guy. I was like, hey, man, look, I can't do this wearing a mask. It was so hard trying to move all this stuff up a hill. And then they have a 25-foot truck. Okay, the average person, let's say between 5'8 and let's say 6'2, they're going to stack it almost 8 to 9 feet tall. So if you move a box, something's going to fall down top of your head. So why do you stack a moon truck that damn high? No one's 10 foot tall to reach to the top. So that's my moving experience. So far, I'm in Bellingham. And, you know, I'm going to be honest with you guys out there, my listeners. For so many years, I've been known as the personal trainer, the bodybuilder, and all that good stuff. And I continue still to work out in the gym because I love working out, and that's what I do. I had a call with my coach because I'm a coach. I have a coach. And it's funny, when the body is ready for transition, it starts to repel certain things it does not like. So in my case, I want to move out of training into full-time coaching 100%. And now, after working some stuff with my own personal coach, I'm all in. You know what? I'm going to have to go to some comfort zones, reach out to new people. I had my first coffee kind of Zoom meet with the person, Leah Vong. She's a nutrition coach, and she used to be a PT. I mean, physical therapist, not personal trainer. And she obviously got out that space, too, to do something more in line with her purpose. So it's pushing me so hard. It's like like my feet are on fire almost. So that's what's up. I'm all in. I have a spreadsheet right next to me of who I need to contact, how I get things set up. And a wonderful thing about that is that I'm pushing myself outside my comfort zone, meeting great new people. And how can I, you know, I guess be known in Bellingham, Washington, small little town, about 90,000 people plus, but how can I make a name for myself? So that's my update. How about you, Gloria? What's going on with you?
So you can almost tell, you can really feel already when you're not feeling what you're doing right now. Like when you're ready for that big change and you already know what you really want, your body's telling you that already. So meaning you're not as motivated and not as happy doing, you know, with a personal training and with the fitness, rather than with when you're doing life coaching?
You know what? That's what it boils down to. Is even though I am training clients currently right now virtually or app-based training, my energy and my mindset and what I want is 100% focused on, you know, who said it the best? When we had Carmen Ray on our podcast last week, she said, come to Teen Road. Ray I'm at Carmen. The T right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Ray Carmen, I'm at the T in the road where I'm looking to the left, which I know training I've been doing for so long. Yeah, known as trainer, blah, 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 blah. Because when people look at me, first thing to be, oh, this guy works out. This guy works in the gym. He's a trainer. And when I was working with my coach, he's like, look, you got to, when people meet you, don't talk about what you used to do. Talk about what you are. Mm-hmm. It's like, dang, that's right. Because while I was on the call with Leah yesterday, and I, you know, here I go, you get trapped in telling your story, right? Which is okay. She thought I was, oh, yeah, so you coaching and nutrition, all that's like, oh, no, I'm actually doing this. Oh, okay, I thought you were kind of doing that one. No, I got to really, now, all of us, if you're in transition, got to be the brand you want. So when people talk about, oh, what do you do? I do this. Don't try to bring up what you used to do in your transition. People don't care. The reality is that you're trying to, I guess, inflate your story more, but we all do the same thing by default. So right now, work with my coach, and I'm going to only talk about that. If you ask questions about it, yes, but only going to talk about this, and I'm all in.
That's funny that you mentioned that. Just kind of reminded me of kind of like what happened to me when I was in a Zoom meeting with two other women. It was about, what were we talking about? We're talking about something else. But anyways, so it was, I was introducing myself to the other one, and she asked me, so what do you do? And I said, oh, I am a physical education teacher at a school. And then the other lady that knows me, she goes, and I go, yeah. And, you know, and I coach volleyball. She goes, and I'm thinking, what do you mean? And I'm looking at her. She goes, something else. You do something else. What is it? And that's when it popped in my head. I said, oh yeah. And I'm also a life coach, but I don't know why I left that out. Maybe because, I don't know. I just started laughing. I was laughing at myself. Why did I leave that out? And she even said it too. She said, why don't you just put that out there? Why don't you just say, you know? And I said, I don't know, because I'm not used to it yet. I'm so used to like, oh yeah, I'm a physical education teacher, you know? But now, because I think, you know, we're working more on being a life coach. And, you know, I think for me, I'm still in the process of maybe just starting and putting myself out there. But, you know, it's just getting used to that too. Getting yourself out of who you were and what people knew what you were doing before to something new now. So you got to take that out of, yeah, I'm a personal trainer, to now becoming a life coach, you know? And that's what happened to me, because at one point it's like, oh yeah, she coaches volleyball and she teaches at the school.
You know what? Here's the bottom line is, and obviously those that haven't said it yet. So we also are part of a mastermind group. So I was reading this book. Sorry, listening to this book called "Thinking Fast and Slow" by Daniel Kuffman. I can't remember the last name, but he says something which I heard before in a book called Atomic Habits. Inherently, our body subconsciously follows the path of least resistance. So for me and for you, talking about trainer, it's a path of resistance. We know it. We've been doing it. You're an educator, volleyball coach. You've been doing it for years. You know it. You're known for it. You talk about it. So inherently, our body follows exactly what the path of least resistance is. I forgot what term you use, but that's pretty much what it is. You're going to follow one that creates less resistance. To talk about something that's new, to talk about something that maybe to some people maybe seem strange as a professional certified life coach or what you do, our bodies always revert back just by default. Oh, it's easy talking about this. So as I talk to people, even in Bellingham, I revert back, oh, I'm a trainer, you know, because that's the first thing people see. So I'm like, wait a minute here. If I really want to transition this, or let's say you want to transition what people think about you, start now. Every time you're going to revert back to the path of least resistance, think about what you want to be known about. Because that's what happens. All of us follow the, what's easy to explain about? Oh, I did this, but I'm in transition here. Be like, what? They're confused. So and then it becomes more difficult to now explain what is a life coach or a professional certified therapist or whatever it is. How do people explain that? Like if you say it's your psychiatrist, if you say you're a therapist, people kind of understand those. Or I'm a doctor. What kind of doctor? I work in an MD field. Okay, I know what that is. And that's what I now know for you and I to get out that comfort zone and really get out there and say, this is what I do. So you can start embodying that brand and that person. So all you talk about is that. Oh, yeah, volleyball. Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, I guess, you know, also for me, at least, because it's just something I'm so used to, it's almost like it's automatic, right? Yeah. When people ask you, what do you do? It's automatic. And, you know, I've gone through I don't know how many changes. I've gone through transitions in my life too of changing careers. And it was, you know, like what you were talking about earlier, I was thinking about that too. It's, you kind of just, in a way, follow what your body tells you or what your heart tells you, right? And I've gone through from being working corporate, you know, in the sales, customer service, and then from being a recruiter to then volleyball coaching, and then volleyball coaching, then I started being a physical education teacher, and then now, you know, with the life coaching. So it was, for a long time, it was corporate. You know, yeah, this is what I do, and I work for whatever company. And then, you know, yeah, I'm a recruiter. And, you know, I love what I do, and I really did. I loved it for so long. I loved to, when I was working corporate, I liked the traveling. one of the good thing about it too is the perks of traveling. And I love that, you know, you get to go to places and whatever, but that was a fun part of it. And then until later on, it was just, this is not for me anymore. I'm not, you know, happy. I think it was, I remember walking into work for like 3 months, every day of that 3 months. And I know how many months, because I really counted, you know, I said 1 month, it's been 1 month. I'm still feeling this way. Every time I come into work, I'm not happy. It's like I'm dragging my feet every morning to work. And then come second month, until the third month, I said, you know what, this has been going too long. I know what I need to do. I need to get out. And, so I took that chance of getting out, and I didn't have a job. I really didn't. Yeah, I didn't. So
that's difficult.
Yeah, it was. And, you know, it was the job that I was at when I was in college is, you know, when I found that job. And then I was there for a while. Then I graduated college and I was, you know, I was there. But I don't know what it was. You know, I was having a lot of fun at work. I remember I used to look forward to it. But, you know, after a while, you kind of start feeling it where, you know, when you're not happy and when you start dragging yourself every day to work, you know, this is not for you anymore. Right. So it's a struggle. And that's what happened to me. It wasn't helping me. It wasn't serving me. And I just felt something different in my body. So I made the decision. I remember leaving. I didn't have a job. I forgot how long I was jobless. And then I found, you know, recruiting. And then I met, I have a friend who started his own recruiting business. So then I went on in with him. And then, you know, we kind of just did a whole recruiting thing with a startup company. So I was doing that for a while. And then again, it was like, oh, I don't know what's going on. And then I decided coaching on the side. And that was, I think, the beginning of, you know, becoming a life coach for me, when I started coaching and I felt something different. And then from coaching, there was an opportunity of, from the school where I coached, there was an opportunity of, you know, would you like to be a physical education teacher? You know, something, you bring in something different to the kids and to the school. And I said, no, that's not me. That took a while to, I think it took me months to make that decision. I said, I'm going to give it a try. And I did. And from then on, again, it's like, there's something here. There's something about, you know, with working with all these kids and realizing that they go through a certain stage in their life and they go through all this negativity that we go through sometimes, you know, like the self-doubt and, you know, when you have that, when you do that, sometimes we have like the self, like, you know, when we do negative talks.
Yeah.
That one. All that is what motivated me to just like, I was happy just, you know, like helping them move forward and getting them out of that state of mind. It became a passion. And I think from then on, it was just something else. Like, I want to be somebody. I want to help these people out. But what is it? What is it called? I knew I didn't want to be a therapist. You know, and I said there was something else. And so that's when I found out and I've discovered becoming a life coach. So since then, just following that and to these days, it's just been, you know, I'm happy. I know what I really want. This is what makes me happy. And just like you transitioning from the fitness world to becoming a life coach, you found something different. Your body's telling you something different about, you know, about being a life coach and helping people. Making a difference, just making an impact, is just the main thing too.
And that's the really woke me up was, it's kind of like Ray talked about in our podcast about we have these awakening moments. Mm-hmm. When I first started the personal training space, it was the awakening moment where it's like, man, you know what? Everybody comes to me to try and lose 20 pounds or get in better shape or build muscle, but nothing's sustainable. And what I mean by sustainable is, they always constantly, okay, I'm trying to lose 20 pounds. They fall off the wagon. They come back. All right, Ron, I got a shit again to fall off the wagon. They always constantly can't develop these consistent habits. You know, I call it the gung-ho, which means the person that wants to go to the gym 8 days a week, which is not 8 days a week, but you get the idea. He wants to go every day on the hour, and he's going to burn himself out in a month. I said, look, you know, fitness is a lifestyle change. It's not something that, you know, you can turn on and off when you want to, like a light switch. So when I start realizing that and realizing how much can I really keep doing this, you know, bending over, re-racking equipment, demonstrating exercises, you know, where can I do this for the next 20 years? Answer is no. So that was an awakening moment there. But, you know, when you make an income, it's how you pay your bills. You kind of just go with the flow, like a treadmill, because you got to make money to pay your bills. And mm-hmm. That's why I'm glad I left California, is that I don't feel that stress of that treadmill. You have to make a certain amount of money just to survive. Mm-hmm. I just don't feel that stress anymore. And that allows my mind not to be extremely creative because less thought is there taking up space in my mind about I got to survive. So that now then comes another awakening moment. And this was a pivotal moment in my life. Mir Ming Hong, we actually went to his first show. He did got, you know, second place in open and second place and I think second open, third place in novice. Anyways, he won a trophy. And I witnessed this personally, and meaning that I also competed for shows, but I never won anything. I just never won. I never won a trophy, never won a plaque, never won anything. Not even got close. And when I saw his passion and his emotion in his eye, looking at me and crying and say, thank you so much, you changed my life. Thank you so much. I'll never forget you. Right then and there, it's like I got shocked again. I woke up. This is not where I belong. And it's, you know, just a few weeks later, we started IPEC together. Mm-hmm. And that was an awakening moment. Mm-hmm. That was, I don't want this. It's not me. And now I realized that to myself, driving home that night, I said, you know what? That's why I never won a trophy. I was all in. You know, I think I told Ray over our last podcast, I did the steroids, I did the over-the-counter drugs, whatever it took, I was doing it, hurting my body, hurting my emotions. You know, and all these crazy things, just trying to win, never happened because I wasn't in line with my purpose.
Yeah. And, you know, that was another thing with that podcast too. After that podcast, I got to thinking a lot after of, you know, me going back to the type of mindset that I have now. How did it start for me, right? Because I remember we talked about opening your third eye. And that's when Ray said, yeah, opening your third eye could be dangerous because once it's open, it's not, you can't stop and it's, you know, nonstop, right? Which is true. And I feel like I'm there. It's almost like I feel like you know, once it's open, we're unstoppable, right? You just want to keep going and going, but you're going because it's something that you love to do. And, you know, the type of my, for you in your case, when you were saying that some, when you were here, you'd always felt the pressure of you had to make a certain amount of, you know, a certain amount. Yeah. You got to try to keep up with everybody here in California or in the Bay Area. Right. So I'm going to be the opposite of that. I can't remember if I was once there in that situation at one point. I really cannot remember. Maybe when I was working corporate, yes, I probably have had those kind of stress too. But something had, I don't know, I can't think. But I remember thinking where I've stopped putting myself in that situation for a long time. And I don't really, you know, look at others or I, you know, of course we can't help but compare ourselves, right? But when it comes to terms to that of trying to keep up and trying to, you know, say and stressing out on like if am I going to make it because, you know, living in the Bay Area is expensive. I try not to stress over that. And I think I've not realized now until now that I've realized I probably worked on myself years ago on that and how I got myself out of that because I'm able to figure something out. Or I've always told myself, well, you know what? I'll figure something out. I'm always going to figure something out. I think that's what I've always told myself. I'm going to figure something out because, you know, it's not like it's going to be the end of the world for me if I don't have any money. You know, but I think there was a time where I've stopped like kind of comparing and trying to keep up.
What I said to myself several times over my last 4 years of making big decisions is I'll make it. When I quit Fry's, I'll make it. When I decide to leave California and go to Bellingham, I'll make it. When I decide to transition out of training to coaching, I'll make it. And see, right then and there, that is a special moment for you. And what I mean by special moment, you're not going to let outside influences or negativity talk you out of what you're doing. And that's a special moment that should be celebrated because you had idea or thought being, I'm going to make it. And whatever that looks like, I'm going to make it. And you transition your mindset because the first thing people think about is, wow, how I make money, how I'm gonna pay my bills, how am I going to do this, how I'm gonna do that, and how this and what's gonna happen, and all these thoughts, they paralyzed by fear of failure. Mm-hmm. But you weren't paralyzed. I wasn't paralyzed. And we should take the moment right now to celebrate that, to say, we actually made something. Because we can be paralyzed. I can be paralyzed right now. I gotta go back to training because I don't make money. Mm-hmm. Paralyzed. But I'm not.
Yeah. I think like, you know, when I had to think about this, you know, parts of it started with, you know, my mom being a single mom. You know, like, how are we going to survive? When I was younger, I probably didn't have those thoughts yet, you know. But when I think back now, I don't know how we survived, but we did. You know what I mean? And then I remember another thing that I remembered was, you know, just going to school and maybe not having enough money for lunch, you know, and just, you know, all my other friends had nice shoes. I had whatever my mom can afford or, you know, even clothing. I had, you know, hand me down sometimes for my cousin. And it was like, you know, but we survived. And then high school now, going to college, you hear, I remember hearing all my other friends are going to like all these nice colleges. And I'm sitting there and I remember, man, you know, that kind of broke my heart because I'd like to go to college, but my mom and I can't afford that, or if we can't afford to go to college, who's going to pay for it, right? So I think I remember in high school seeing all that and growing up, I had to start working. So I stopped asking my mom for money. And then I remember going to college. It was that would be another accomplishment for me because I never thought I'd be able to go to college because my mom and I can't afford it. But again, that's another thought of there's a way we're going to get through this. We'll figure something out. And we did. we figured something out. I figured something out and I was able to put myself to college. You know what I mean? And even just getting my first car, it was, you know, like, how am I going to do that? So I think all that I had probably started to meet, had started for me at a young age, because I knew that somehow you'd have, you can't, like, I think I was talking about this one time about insecurity.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That you cannot let your, what was it? I heard it somewhere. And when you always look at people and you look at them, they're all, you're looking at them above you all the time, that type of insecurity is what's going to hold you back on achieving anything that you want to achieve or on going, getting somewhere where you want to get. So basically insecurity is what kills more, what kills your dreams more than failure ever will. Because how would you know? You haven't even failed because you didn't even try. So how would you know?
You're a fail by not trying.
Exactly. So that I'm thinking, wow, I've already been going through it. I didn't even realize, you know, that I was already doing all that. So now after that podcast with Ray, that's when I realized, gosh, you know, I really had to turn around and change, you know, my mindset on a lot of things, which now looking back and then looking at me now, it's, you know, what I've really learned a lot growing up and all my experiences, that I wouldn't be where I am now and I wouldn't have this kind of mindset and this type of awareness now if I didn't go through all that.
That's certainly true. It says celebrate that. When you're talking about your story, I read this in this book called The Daily Stoic. So pretty much Ryan Holiday had this book where you read a page a day, 365 days. And one of the pages I read last week, it's pretty much, it's about Seneca and their philosophy. But to sum it up, I remember verbatim, I don't remember every single word, but if you think about it in life, you have been through worse. So whatever you're going through right now, you have been through worse and you've made it. So when you talk about your story, I remember back in 2012, 2013, I was going through a rough time financially. I was dating this girl and, you know, I was trying to be the great guy. So what happens is we have a 520 square foot apartment. So it was me, her, and her two kids living there. I was paying the rent, you know, trying to help her get back on her feet because, you know, she's struggling. That's the idea is. I remember trying to help her out and be that guy. You know, I put the cell phones in her name, make sure the cell phone bill got out of control. It's like $300 or $400 a month. The rent was in my name. I remember we broke up, and obviously, you know, the funny thing about the situation, I will never forget this. I have to tell the story if I haven't told it already, but I remember one time I'm dating this girl. We're living together. I didn't have a bank account at the time, right? I mean, I was pretty much going to these places, going to where my check was getting cashed or where my check was bank account. I think it was Cold America at the time in California. I was cashing my check and getting cash. So I gave her cash to actually pay the light bill. The light bill was like $175, whatever it was at the time. I gave her the cash. I said, hey, you're off today. She said, yes. I said, okay, here's the cash to pay the bill. She's like, okay, cool. So I come home that night, like, hey, did you take care of the bill? Because subconsciously, our intuition is pretty funny. I'm already looking for a receipt because I don't trust the person. If you trust the person, you wouldn't be thinking about a receipt. About, man, I don't know, I have to be 3 or 4 weeks later, power gets cut off. She's like, oh, text me, hey, power's off. It's like, what happened? Is power off in the neighborhood? She's like, I don't know. All right, so I call PG&E up, and then the first thing you know, do is put your zip code in. You know, there's no power shortages recorded in your area. We'd like to speak to a customer representative. Sure, press zero. Talk representative, says, yeah, so Mr. Johnson, take a look here. Yeah, so I see here in I think it was June, I see here you wrote a check. I said, I wrote a check. So yeah, you wrote a check in the balance. I say, you know what? I thank you for taking your time. I apologize. I hung up the phone. I call her up. I'm yelling at her because I said, so when you paid light bill, did you pay check or cash? She said, whatever you gave me. I said, the question was specific. Did you pay check or cash? Whatever you gave me. I said, that's not the answer. You paid check and you bounced a check. So so we got into a big argument. She left and I'm stuck now. I got to pay this electricity bill. I got to pay my cell phone bill was like $720. I was behind on that. That's how far I got up high. And I remember at that time, I only had $20 in my name. I had to pay all my bills. spring, I call it spring. I'm begging with lady. I says, look, you know, I don't get 20 bucks in my name. What can you do? Tell you what, Ms. Johnson, I give you one more week, 2 more weeks. I won't turn your cell phone off. I said, thank you so much. I'm begging, pleading. And, you know, when hearing your story, when I went through that time period back 2012 or 13, man, if I look at my time now, transitioning from trainer to coach, I'm okay because I've been through worse. And that right there, for you guys out there, that's how you transition the mindset through these negative thoughts that you're working through. We all work through negative self-talk into positivity is that, well, I know I've been through worse. I can make this. That's how you transcend thoughts.
Isn't that crazy?
It's really crazy when you see and really think about it. We have that time and freedom of mind. And that's what's good about meditation that we do in our virtual seminars is it's like, wow, you know, I've been through a lot worse. Mm-hmm. I remember I'm dating the same girl. So back in 2012, 13, 14, you know, California gas prices were getting out of control. It's like $4 or $5, almost $6 a gallon. And she had this Dodge Charger. Like I never seen a car. I never driven a car. She had a Dodge Charger on 22-inch rims, blacked out. That freaking car was like a police magnet. The police is going to just run your place, just run it. Just because you fit a description, whatever it is. So at that time, she had a long commute, you know, and she had kids, stuff like that. So we added a little 4-cylinder, and that car was a 6-cylinder, right? And 6-cylinder means more power. She's going through gas. She's got a person where instead of filling up her gas, she'll put $20 in her gas tank every 2 days. So like Monday, she put $20. By Tuesday, she's out. Wednesday, she put another $20. I said, why don't you just fill it up? Well, I like the way I'm doing it, only $20 at a time. I'm like, all right, whatever. So we ended up changing cars, and I told her, I said, hey, look, you know, I'm going to get oil change on her charger. So I'm going to get oil change. Make sure my car get oil change. Again, I come home, I check, right? Because, you know, we get oil change. I don't know about now, but then they give you that little sticker. Hey, oil change at X amount of miles or date. I look, I said, it's not there. So I go upstairs to the apartment. I said, hey, did you get oil change? Yeah, I did it. I says, that's funny. Where's the sticker at? I don't see it. What do you mean? I said, the sticker that tells you next oil change. Oh, my friend, he must have forgot it. I said, what friend? Well, I know Scott, the mechanic, and here comes the BS, right? Because obviously I look for a sticker. There's a reason why. Mm-hmm. About a month and a half later, damn it, I get the call and the car broke down. I said, what happened to the car? I don't know. It stopped working. It stopped broke down. All right, so I called to my boss. Hey, you know, my girlfriend at the time, she has emergency car broke down. So it's like a 30-minute drive away from where I was, you know, from San Jose to Hayward. So I get to Hayward, and when you break down the freeway, Caltrans automatically sends you to the next exit, and you got to call for help. I get there. First thing I do is pop open the hood. I check the dipstick at the time. You know, the car had a dipstick. It is bone dry. I'd never seen it that corrosive, meaning that it was just caked on grease. It was like grayish color. Open up the radiator, bone freaking dry. So the idea is that because when you run out of antifreeze or run out of radiator fluid or water and you run out of oil, pretty much the engine was seized and won't turn over. She doesn't know what happened. Mm-hmm. Oh my God. And luckily I knew a guy. He was very nice to me. He repaired the cars and I repaired my car. And for about a month and a half, I'm pretty much driving from my apartment to Hayward to drop her off, then take myself to work. She would take the bus home or I think BART or whatever it was to get home to the apartment every single day because we could not afford to pay a mechanic to get our car out.
Damn, that's a struggle.
That's some stories I've been through. I tell people these stories. It's not really, it's not really funny. That's what happened. I couldn't pay the guy. Car sat there for like 2 months, almost 3 months before I was able to get enough money to pay. And that means that I had to take a 401k loan to pay the guy back. I had to, you know, borrow money, whatever it took to pay him back. And it was a complete, utter, just, I mean, actually, we didn't pay him back until, hold on, that happened October, November. Oh, no, we didn't pay him back until she got her tax return in January. Almost 3 to 4 months the car sat there. That's a struggle. Wow. I think clearly, yep, I had to wait 4 months to pay them when we got tax return and I have money to get and her tax return to pay the car off.
Boy. You know, there's, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say with all this, like, you know, sometimes the struggles that you go through in life and, just the things sometimes where you feel like you're not going to survive, you're not going to be able to handle or take anymore. It's when you actually sometimes just change those thoughts in your head, and a lot of them are all just mainly negative, and you change it to something more positive, that I'll get through this, or you know what, eventually I'll have the money to pay for this and it'll work out. But in the meantime, you're going through the struggle of like driving like 40, 45 minutes back and forth, you know?
Yeah, because from my house to Hayward's about 35, say, you know, about 20 minutes, because she worked early in the morning. But from Hayward down in San Jose, you're on that 880 corridor, and traffic is a nightmare. So I had to do is before time changes. So that time didn't sunrise at 8 o'clock. I hop in a carpool lane, because my idea was when a carpool lane is dark, a car can't really see and pull you over for carpool, because you can't see the car, you can't see the side. Mm-hmm. So that's what I was doing, taking carpool, flying down there. I mean, oh my God. I mean, you're going through gas like crazy, like $400 or $500 a month in gas because of all that driving around.
Yes.
Oh my.
I can't imagine.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. If I didn't go through those experiences, mm-hmm. either one, I would have faced them later on in life, but they woke me up to a much bigger and greater purpose of who I am today. Those experiences made me who I am. Because here's the idea is, I was so afraid of being alone because of low self-esteem, low confidence. I didn't have the energy or the fortitude to actually say, look, this is not working out for me. Because once I got rid of her, things got better. That's really what happened. Okay. Mm-hmm. I was able to financially get back on my feet and things worked out. We got back together after all that fiasco too, because again, I was afraid of being alone. But someone had taught me early in life how to build confidence and realize, wait a minute. What I'm going through with this person, you know, I hate being alone. I'm afraid to be alone, and I'm going to miss sex. I'm going to miss all this great stuff. Wait a minute here. This person isn't serving me. So what will serve me? I only learned this after the mindset. So these are great things I've been through in my life. I can share with you guys out there, because everybody's going through what I went through. It can be in a marriage. It can be in a relationship. It can be in a job. It can be whatever. They're facing these crises right now. But how do you get out of it? Well, if you're in a marriage and you're somehow you're codependent upon the person, and you're staying because you're codependent upon another person, but you want to leave, but you can't because of the money. Okay. Is this relationship serving you? No, it's not. What will serve you? You tell the person what will serve you.
Yeah.
So these are great experiences I've been through because they made me and who I am today. I'm serving you guys.
Exactly. And that's with, you know, with a lot of us. And these are the things that I think, you know, for us, what we'd like to help a lot of our clients and a lot of other people out there is, you know, just to kind of change that type of like that negative thoughts mindset that they have, because sometimes they get so stuck and there's no more hope. But they don't realize if you just kind of change that, turn that around and say, well, you know what, maybe if I do it this way, or maybe if I do that, just do something about it, then, you know, maybe there will be hope. You know what I mean? And it's just like, I was just thinking, even with a lot of the kids nowadays, you know, with school, I know there's a lot of pressure at school and colleges, and then going to college and then trying to survive and, you know, how am I going to make extra money because I need to buy this or whatever. But you know what? When I hear a lot of what I call whining, a lot of kids out there whining about this stuff, like, oh, you know, I have this many hours of school and I have so much, I have a lot of homework. I don't know if I'll survive. Or those who says, well, I can't work, not even part-time, because I have to focus on school, but we can't afford certain things, whatever, right? But you know what? Guess what? This is what I like to tell a lot of the kids. I get it. I understand. But there's people out there, like, let's say me, who had, and I like to tell my stories because they don't realize, a lot of these kids don't realize that this is possible and you can do this. When I went to college, I was going to school 6 days a week because I wanted to finish. And I didn't have any summer for 4 years. Okay. I was going to school 6 days a week. Saturday was all day. And then my summer, I took classes during the summer full time. And on top of that, I was working full time. So I was a working student. So when I think back, how did I do it? I don't know how I did it, but I did. Because I think I was so focused on what I wanted to, accomplish. And I just did it. So, you know, now with the kids that out there right now who sometimes loses hope of like college is hard, it's crazy, or even just high school or middle school, I'm sorry, but it is hard. It is a lot of pressure. But if you just don't think that way and focus on something else, what are you really trying to accomplish? Why are you really in school? Maybe it'll be different, you know?
That is certainly true. I mean, when you're going through your situations like that, you're just going through the motions and you don't think. So when you look back like, dog, you know, I could have made it. Mm-hmm. But you look back now like, I don't want to do that again. And I made it.
I so surely wouldn't, but I did it. I don't know how I did it. But I was, you know, younger, like I had a lot more energy and all these other kids that has a lot of energy, they can do it. Even just cleaning the house or helping around the house. It's like, what happened? A lot of these kids have gotten so lazy, you know, and I don't get it. But again, it's those thoughts that comes to mind. I can't do this. I can't do that. This is too much. It's too much pressure, or I can't run because something is hurting, whatever it is. But the more you think that way, the more, of course, it's going to be like that for you because that's how you're thinking. But if you change that and say you can, or like, I can do this, even if I'm hurting, I'm probably just hurting for a little bit, but it'll probably go away tomorrow. I'm sore today. I won't be sore tomorrow, but I have to keep going. You know, it'll be a different story. And like I said, I don't know how I did it. I mean, I remember I would be up until like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning doing an essay, and I had to go to work at 8 o'clock in the morning the next day.
Wow. But you did it.
But I did it, you know? So if I can do it, anybody else can do it. And I know I'm not the only one out there. There's so many other people that, you know, goes through a lot of the struggles and all these obstacles and, you know, just to be who they are today. And just listen to all our other guests in our podcast, all their journey of, you know, of becoming like Ray Carmen, right? Becoming of who she is now, just the triumphs and the obstacles that she's gone through in her life and the trauma.
Yeah. And that's made her who she is. I'm thankful for everything I've been through, the pain, the suffering, the guilt, the doubt, the everything is who I am today.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm thankful for everything. It's fantastic. Because if I didn't go through that, I wouldn't be living in my purpose. I wouldn't be living the dream, as people would say, living the dream.
Isn't that crazy? And you know what? Here's what I got to say about that. It's no matter how old you are, you're never too old to even discover your purpose. And it could be later on in life. It could be in your 50s or 60s, whatever it is. Just keep in mind that you're never too old.
You know, so you bring me up to another point. I had an example game with my mom. So she was, she texted Karina the other day about something about, I guess she was at Starbucks, and Starbucks, the person didn't manage a 6 foot distance and all this stuff. You know, it's okay. First of all, manage six foot distance is unmanageable right now. If you haven't figured that out already, it's really hard to manage, especially in areas that are crowded, right? If you're at the beach, it's easy. If you're in a hotel, it's easy, you know. Those things are easier, but places like Starbucks, Walmart, Target, you know, places where people have to go, it's hard to manage that six foot distance. So what happened in conversation with mom today, she says, well, I'm upset. I says, well, what happened? She says, well, I took a step back. You know, she's got upset while yelling at her. I wasn't there. I'm here in this third party, right? So I'm granted my mom's probably saying, I got to watch myself. The loss of 6 foot distance, you're not doing it. You got to do your job. People are going to do it how they want to do, okay? Face reality. So mom gets upset. She says, well, I call Starbucks and ask them, you know, what are you guys doing to manage people? Make sure people are following the laws of 6 foot distance. Mask is mandatory, okay? 6 foot distance. She says, the person tells her, which my mom told me, that everybody has a right. So mom then says, you know, I'm going to write a letter to Starbucks because this is ridiculous. That's his mom. Let's look at this thing, two perspectives. First of all, the person you talk to, I know you're probably not going to say the name, but how's that going to help you? It's really hard for companies, I don't care if it's a $1 billion company, to manage this whole thing. Our government can't manage this whole thing. How can a company do it? I said, well, you made a choice. Your choice was to go to Starbucks. That's a choice. You don't have to go to Starbucks. You can stay at home and make your own coffee. Well, you know, I only go there once a week or once a month, you know, and everybody should be following the protocol. No one's going to follow the protocol. You can't expect someone to do what you're doing. So then I realized, talking to my mom about that, I realized, and I have to accept, just like Ray said again, I accept she wants to write a letter because that's what she feels she needs to do, but you're still alive. You waste the energy on that. Shouldn't you want to spend your energy? But this is me. Yeah. This is me saying, don't you want to spend your energy on something more productive? Writing a letter is going to do what? Well, then every time I go to Walmart, I'm going to Sprouts, I'm going to ask the manager the same thing. How is that going to help you? You think they understand what that means? When someone says, well, people have that people don't need to manage their own distance, you think, how is it going to serve you? It's not. But I have to accept my mom. She's going to do what she wants to do.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. Because you telling her and asking her that, it's you speaking already about you, not her.
Yes.
So, yeah, I agree. She's entitled to whatever she's feeling, entitled to her own opinion and whatever it is that she wants to do. That's, you know, if that floats her boat, then go ahead, you know, but it's not you.
No, it's not.
Yeah. And I totally understand that. And I agree with your mom. I understand her, where she's coming from, because I too have gone through that with my mom, you know, and it's a lot better now with her, because I used to do the same thing to her. Now I just let her do whatever she wants. She wants to complain. She wants to get mad. Go ahead. Go tell your boss. Go tell them. Because you know what? Is that going to make you feel better? Yeah. Okay. Then go ahead. Why am I going to stop her? So same thing with your mom. If you know what, that's going to make her feel better, let her.
Yep, you're right about that. That's it. I gotta keep my mouth shut. Now it's gotta listen. That's what I said. It's gotta listen now.
Yep. You just have to listen and roll your eyes sometimes.
Yes. And just say, accept. It is what it is.
Yeah.
That's you know, anyways, that's a different story.
All right.
But you know what? This is another great Freestyle No Topic Thursday. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Hope you guys learned something. Hope you know you have a choice. You can live the best life you have. And anything you're going through right now, you've been through worse, and you will get through it. So thanks again for listening to another episode of Lifestyle Shuffle. This is Ron Johnson, your life coach.
And this is your life coach, Gloria. And again, thank you for listening to another episode of Lifestyle Shuffle.